Hi guys, I'm back. Got a few changes here. Number one, I got a new camera. I can't show the camera because I'm using it right now, but here's the box. It's a Nikon Coolpix L840. And I'm just getting used to it. I've only done like one little simple test video with it. So bear with me. It is high definition, and right now I'm recording high definition. I can adjust it down. I have chose not to. So it's 1080 with 30 frames per second. And we'll see how well this works out. My upload speed's 1 megabit per second. So I don't know how big this video will be. Excuse me, I'm also dealing with a cold. So anyway, it may be that, except for short videos, it may be a little too much, too long of upload speed, taking me too long to upload. So this may be the only, as far as a lengthy video, that'll be in at least this high definition. But anyway, I did get this, so I wanted to show that to you. That's not really what this video is about. This is to answer some questions from a person who watched some very old videos of mine. Way back when I first kind of got started in making videos, I did a video, did a series of videos on radio theory. And I actually managed to find the schematic I used. So anyway, I wanted to kind of quickly go through some of his questions and try to answer them. So we'll just do that, and we'll see how well we can get by with here. So the first question has to deal with, and I don't know if you can see that. I can zoom in. It seems to do pretty good about focusing. Let me do some adjustment here, and with this. And zoom in just a little bit more. Focus. Okay. This capacitor here, the 470 picofarad. And, you know, basically he was curious about that and its location. Okay, first of all, this is to answer one part of his question. This or correct something here. This does not block anything. It blocks AF, audio frequency, but it doesn't block RF frequency. What it does do, this is actually connected to this point here, which comes right down here, and this is our ground plane, or negative, B minus. So, this is your ground, your circuit ground. So this side is connected to circuit ground. This side is connected over this point here, which is going in the grid. Now, his question was, why was it hooked here instead of over here? And basically, I think one of the reasons why they did this was, and I don't remember for sure, but I believe this thing is a couplet. In other words, some of these resistors and capacitors are actually in a on a substrate all together, and then you hook that into the circuit. If not the a little later model of this, or a little bit higher model, it was a couplet. In either case, it doesn't matter actually technically where you hook this. What you're doing is trying to remove any RF that may still be coming from here, the detector, first audio, and feeding into grid. Now, technically, you're not going to hear it, but it can cause a little bit of problems with the audio output tube. And once in, you know, there is a slight possibility of slight distortion, very rare, but one of the things it can do, if it mix is just right. In other words, if I can get a harmonic here or a mixture between audio frequency, right audio frequencies, and this RF energy. At some point, one the two peaks may actually add, and if it's a strong enough audio signal, I could actually get a little bit of positive on this grid. It's possible, but the best, ultimate best thing to do is try to keep as much RF off. Most of your filter is done right here, but it's always customary somewhere in this lead, this connection going from the plate of the first audio to the grid of the output tube, to put another little bit of RF filtering. And the way they do that is they use something in the picofarad range and hook it on there to pull that RF back to ground. The RF will easily pass through here, but the AF won't. So it matters not where it's hooked. Actually, if you find it's hooked back here, it might actually be a little bit smaller, like a 250 picofarad. You're using a 450 here, probably because the signal had made it all the way through. Both signals are coming through this 0.01, and so there could have been a little bit of mixing, possibly. But anyway, 470 is fine. I'm not going to try to second guess the engineers who designed the radio. But it matters not where it's actually hooked in here. A lot of times you'll see it drawn this way. Sometimes you'll see it drawn here if there's a couplet done, because it was just easier for them to hook it up that way on that substrate when they created the substrate. So I hope that answers it anyway. Now the other question is going to be a little more in detail here, because something I have not really done talked about going over AC yet. But the question was, is looking at the DC voltages here. You may not be able to see this, but this is 3.2 DC resistance on the voice coil, and the DC resistance of the secondary on the audio output transformer is 0.5 ohms. And his question basically was gearing at, isn't that a mismatch? Shouldn't these two be matched? Not when you're looking at the DC. In fact, this is quite normal, and there's reasons for it. But first of all, what is matching is impedance, which is different than DC resistance. Although the DC resistance, the resistance of the windings, of the wire that makes up the windings in both these coils, the secondary here and the voice coil, that is used in figuring impedance. In fact, what is used in figuring impedance on here will be the DC resistance, the inductive reactance. This is an inductor. It's a coil. It has inductance. This is a coil. It has inductance. So we got to take into account the inductive reactance. And there is some capacitance here. There is what is known as inner coil capacitance. It's actual capacitance between each turn from wire to wire, from turn to turn. There's a little bit of capacitance. That all adds up to a certain amount of capacitance in each one of these coils. So that capacitive reactance. Now, we actually sum them together. We square them, sum them, and take square root. But it's not quite that simple. So we're going to do a little drawing to show you how this works and what impedance really is. And let's back up just a teeny bit. Okay, and I'm going to turn her down a little bit and rotate just a little bit. There we go. All right. First of all, basically we're going to look at a basic graph that we use, and it's going to represent kind of a Well, we're gonna call it the reactances, but also it's actually based off the voltages. So anyway, first of all, the first part of the graph comes out here, and if I get a marker that will actually work, would be great. I need to buy some new ones. Okay, here we go. And we're going to come out like this. This here, this horizontal line, represents DC resistance. It's pure resistance. And what I mean is, it's the resistance of the wires in the coil, or it can be a carbon resistor, it can be anything. Anything that is a pure resistance. In other words, it has no inductance, has no capacitance. So we just call it R, resistance. Because a resistor, if you're looking at a carbon resistor, it acts the same and exactly the same whether it's got AC across it or it's got DC across it. So nothing changes. It doesn't care whether it's AC or DC. Going from this point up, we're going to put inductive reactance, which is marked X sub L. Now, I did videos on what inductive reactance is and what capacitive reactance is, so you have to look back over those. But there's one other one. I said there's capacitance in there. It actually goes down. Now, it's going to be smaller because it's mostly an inductive coil. So I'm going to shorten it a little bit here. That's X sub C, inductive reactance, or capacitive reactance, X sub C. And I know my voice is crackling up. It's basically because of the cold. All right. Now, I don't know if this is going to be a multi-part, try to answer all of it. He asks a lot of questions, so we're going to try to get through this quick. Since this is high definition, I'm watching my time real close. I didn't buy a new card. I only got like an 8 gig card. So now, there's a formula for impedance, and we do impedance as Z equals square root of something. Now, what that is, it's effectively the hypotenuse here. But these two, first of all, this length, this effective length that's going to be here on this X sub L, what is that? And we got the X sub C here. These two subtract each other. So when they subtract each other, we have a whole new thing, which will be kind of more towards about like this. I'm trying to draw it to scale, but it's probably not going to be quite the same. Like this. And we'll just call this X because it's both these added together, but they actually subtract. They're going opposite directions. And this crossed here will be Z. Now, it's a square, it's a right triangle. Anybody remembers basic algebra, basic math, geometry? A right triangle can be easily figured. The square of the two sides equals the square of the hypotenuse. So A squared plus B squared equals C squared. That's where this comes from. But actually what we'd have is R squared here plus X sub L squared minus X sub C squared. We bring that out, we'll get the X squared, and then we add the two, the R squared to it. Take the square root of that sum, we get impedance. Now, this can be different in the two different coils, as it is on this schematic. But due to the differences in the size of the coils, the diameter of the coils, the number of turns, and the like, the inductance is also quite different between these. What ends up working out is the inductance here will be actually higher, or actually lower than the inductance on the secondary of that winding. Part of it is this has got a bare core that it's working with, but it also has far more windings than this coil does here. Although it doesn't increase in DC resistance because it's actually larger winding. The wire size is larger than the wire size in here. That's why this is actually quite a bit higher resistance, even though this has actually got more windings. With this increased inductance, and roughly the difference will be kind of similar in respect to the difference in resistance. But we also got the capacitance in there that's going to be a little different and stuff. When it works out, and you actually work out the math and use this formula and everything for these two different coils, you will find that their impedance comes vitally close. Now, the other part of the question had to do with shouldn't with inductive reactance and capacitive reactance frequencies involved in the formulas. And the frequencies are always going to constantly change. You know, it's audio. You know, it's not one single tone that's considered noise. So we're not running a signal or audio generator in there at, say, 400 hertz constantly. Shouldn't that change? You know, it's going to change reactances and everything. Wouldn't that change how the load over here, the reflected back, and the effective load or apparent load that's on here, the impedance of the primary? Yes, it will. But believe it or not, it really doesn't change it that much, because you got to remember simply that yes, I've got reflective, but also got a little bit of something going on here by itself. Which is that primary. The reflected back has to do with the turns ratio, and not so much has anything to do with frequency. So as much as this impedance may change because of the frequency changing, the impedance over here will change too, a little bit. But the actual ratio, because the turn ratio and the reflected back will still stay fairly stable and keep this load resistance very stable. Now, I know I'm not really explaining it extremely well, and I'm sorry I'm not. It's kind of hard to do without going through a lot of math and doing a lot of math on this, but effectively, the primary itself has its own, by its lonesome, impedance. And it actually can be, since they're out of phase, because it's a primary to a secondary, there's a little bit out of phase here. What ends up happening is this impedance will have a little bit of subtraction on this impedance. But the reflected, on the reflected coming back, how much that changes depends on how much that the actual difference in value has to do with the frequency. But what ends up working out over the normal frequency range of the transformer, and I'm not sure what it is on this one, I don't know the specs, but it could be like something like the nominal range is somewhere like maybe say 100 hertz to 6,000 kilohertz, or maybe 400 hertz to 10,000 kilohertz or something like that. Audio transformers comes in a variety of different frequency ranges. Now, they work below and above that, but they're tuned or set for their efficiency to work best at those in that range. When as long as it stays in it's in that range, the reflected back, as opposed to what's actually here, its impedance will work out so that difference will still stay steady state for what this tube's looking for a load, whether that's 6,000 ohms or 8,000 ohms or 10,000 ohms. it will stay pretty steady across that frequency range. So I hope I explained it good enough. Now, the only reason why I haven't really got into this is one other little part. And I need to mention it. So bear with me. But I'm not going to go in deep. I'm only going to mention it. We've got this here. Suppose. Now you see that we have the formula here. X sub L subtracts X sub C. What happens if X sub C is quite large? Well, then we end up with our formula equaling R plus X sub L squared minus X sub C squared. But if X sub C is considerably larger, this becomes a negative out here. So what you end up with would be something like this. We'd have R now minus, and we're just going to put, when I do this, it's just going to be X, just reactants. And of course, both squared. But they're squared before this operation is done. Now, if R is a sufficient size, in other words, when I square this value and I square this value, this is larger, we're fine. But it doesn't always happen that way. There are times when R will be small enough that when I square it and I square the my reactants, it comes out larger. So then I end up with a square root of a negative here in here. Square root of negative is normally not allowed. Because in order to get a negative, you have to take two opposites. In other words, a positive times a negative gives you a negative. When you're squaring something, you're squaring the sign as well. So if I square, say, minus 5, I get plus 25. Because a negative times a negative is a positive. If I square just plus 5, I get plus 25. Nowhere will I ever get a minus 25 when I square something, squaring 5. But this could very well be a negative. Now, there's a little trick in mathematics called imaginary numbers. In electronics, it's called J factor. But in mathematics, it's marked as a little I. Electronics does not use I because little I is used for AC current. And discussing like tubes or transistors and how they're reacting and stuff. So we do not, they don't use it. They used J, a little J, a dot on top. Anyway, not capital J. Capital J is joules. So they use a small J. But what basically, in a nutshell, what you do with this is there's a whole bunch of properties with imaginary numbers, but one of the basic properties that deals with this is that if I take I and I square it, I get a negative 1. Okay, so in other words, if I was going to draw this out, and we'll use I, okay? So, anyway, I come out, I got I squared, that equals negative 1. So, in a case like that, what this answer would be, when I come out, will be my impedance, but it will also have a factor of I to it. So, this will be I over here, with a number, some sort of number, that's equaling my impedance. You know, let's say this is 25. It would be 5I5 or 5I would be my impedance. I has no actual value. So at this point, you don't care about it. You can just say it's 5 ohms. You don't have to write down it's 5I ohms or anything else. All the eye is going to tell you is that you must have had a negative, which meant you had a very large capacitive reactance in your impedance formula. That's all I'm going to say about this. This gets into quite a bit of math, or a little unusual math. It's abstract thinking math. We're dealing with imaginary numbers. But I wanted to point that out. That's why I hadn't really went too in-depth in impedance. But if you go to college and take electronics, you're going to go through courses of this, dealing with imaginary numbers. And they'll call it the J factor, because again, in electronics, a small I is AC current. It's known as dynamic current. And where a large I is known as stationary or fixed current. Instantaneous current is another name for it. So they use a small J. A capital J is known as joules, which is amount of energy. So anyway, I want to show that. It's saying I got like about 2 minutes left here. Let's see. Oh, one other little thing. One thing I'll answer real quick. The other question asked was dealing with these two diode plates here, and one of them is going to ground. It comes down here, hooks the cathode, comes down, and hooks down to the B minus. Want to know why they did that? Why wasn't the two connected in parallel, or something? It's just the way they did it. Some companies will pull the second diode to ground. Some will make use of the second diode as the AVC only, where the first diode will be for rectifying or detecting. The second one will be for AVC. Some will go ahead and connect the two together and just act as one, parallel them together and connect them together. It's just up to what that engineer was wanting to do at that point in time. Is, you know, actually in the radio, this would be just pulled and hooked here and hooked right to a ground point. So that's the only reason. The one thing they won't do is leave it open. It's either going to go ground, connect to the other diode, or be used as the AVC circuit. So anyway, I'm going to stop the video here. If I come back immediately on this video, it meant I went ahead and continued on with this. I need to see the file size to know whether I want to go ahead and upload this. If I decide to upload this, consider this part one, answering questions on the radio theory and kind of going through it. Otherwise, it'll just be more of one whole video. Thanks for watching, guys. Okay, guys, I'm still with you. So forget about that part where I said thanks. Well, don't forget it. Again, thanks for watching, but actually this is not part two. This is continuance. It turns out this camera records for a half an hour. Roughly a half hour recording time is at high definition about half of my 8 gig card. So I still had some room on there, but I went ahead and got rid of it. Uploaded it to my computer, and then so I'd have more room. Okay. Now, I'm going to kind of go through these a little in a different arrangement here of the questions he asked. But I wanted, mainly because I wanted to hit talking about the front end here in the oscillator. I need to, let me zoom in on that first. Okay. I need to kind of clarify some things. I made a mistake here in the first video in naming, basically some terminology and naming. These were some of the first videos I put up. It was early on, over a year ago, 2 years ago almost. So, number one, the camera that I was using, I used a lot for taking still pictures, but I had never used it much for video other than just kind of playing around with it. So I wasn't, I was holding it and wasn't really caring, how well it did. When I started making videos on YouTube, I was constantly more concerned about what the camera's doing. The other thing about this was, so my mind's on that part of the time. The other part of this is I'm getting more comfortable with doing these, but I'm a teacher, retired, but teacher nonetheless. So I'm used to being in a classroom with students, people sitting there looking at me while I'm explaining things and teaching. I get interaction by both them asking questions and stuff immediately, but also by just making eye contact with them. I could, look at any one of the students and I could tell if they're getting it or they're lost. If I see any students are a little lost, I'd take, kind of go over it more, and stuff. Making a video, it's not until after it's up before you guys see it and then make comments, and that's the only time we get interaction. So to me, all I'm seeing is just the screen and what I'm pointing at and are doing, and I kind of feel self-conscious. I feel like I'm talking to myself when I'm really not. I'm talking to you guys, but still, right here, right now, there's no one else here, and I'm basically like talking to a camera. So anyway, with all that going on, I make mistakes. I'm human. So I mistakenly called L5 the tickler coil, and it's not. L6 is the tickler. It's 0.8 ohms. L7, which is part of the tank circuit, this is the oscillator circuit tank, it's 13 ohms. Obvious, and they're basically, they are the same gauge of wire. So this has a lot less turns of wire than this coil has. This is the tickler. It's going from my B minus up through to the cathode of the tube. Now you might ask, how's that still work? Where's the completed circuit? Well, the completed circuit is, it goes up through here, and we hit. Let me get something better to point at with, maybe a pencil. We're hitting this grid. Now this grid's got a 94 volts positive on it, which actually happens to be higher than the actual plate circuit in this tube. This acts as an anode, as a plate, for the oscillator section, which is this grid, and the cathode. So I have a current flow coming up through that coil, through here to this grid, and coming back down, going back through the power supply and back to negative. So there's your circuit. Now, what's this coil doing? This is my feeder coil. This coil is going to feed. It's coupled in to here. So this is actually wrapped. It's shown separate, but these coils are all wrapped over top of each other. This coil is wrapped right over top of this, and it is magnetic coupled. What this oscillator is doing, magnetic couples to this coil, which is then fed to the grid. Now remember, the grid, any grid, this grid is high impedance. So this easily gets a voltage showing up on here that's changing. And what that does, a little bit of that voltage changes the amount of current. That voltage is changing the amount of current going through the tube, but it's also transferring into this tube this frequency, the varying current that's going through here, and that's how we get our mixing. But also, that change in current gives the kickback that we need for this tickler coil to keep this thing oscillating. Now, when this thing would be first turned on, current flows through this tube once it heats up. When that happens, this is magnetic and coupled, inductive coupled, to this coil. That induces a voltage into this coil, which then will immediately start charging this capacitor. This is only here for a short a duration, anyway. This will charge up and then it shuts down. The magnetic coupling actually gets equal. We don't have more induction into it. The coil starts, the capacitor starts discharging because there's no more magnetic coupling, because the two are actually equal in voltage. So then the capacitor is at full charge. It starts discharging in the opposite direction, which induces into this coil, which then changes the current going through the tube. And by doing that, it changes this, which changes the kick. Once the thing gets started, you will find that there's quite a variance on here on this coil versus this to this coil. It keeps it going, acts as a kick. These operate not so much in Class C operation. So they're actually in Class A operation. But since it's in the cathode of the circuit, the current, the actual voltage here is a lot lower. But this is how we get the signal in. And what we're actually seeing is the varying that this is doing on the grid. As this voltage goes one direction or the other direction, it becomes more negative, less current flows through the tube. Becomes more positive or heading less negative, then more current flows through the tube. So more negative, less negative, more current. And that is oscillating. And then, of course, we've got our signal coming in, the two mix up, and the difference will be the 455. Now, he asked, he asked something towards effect about that I mentioned there's four different basic frequencies, and there is inside the tube. Let me kind of adjust this, and we're going to go a little bit closer in if I can. Oops, sorry, wrong way. Focus. Okay. Now we're outside the coils here, but the bottom part of this is our oscillator. So that's our local oscillator, and it's got its frequency. Its frequency will always be higher by 455, because that's what the IF is, than what the antenna is tuned for. So in other words, if the antenna was tuned to 1,000 on the scale, then the oscillator would be at 1,455. So, but what comes out of here is four fundamental frequencies, and there's a whole bunch of harmonics. Don't worry about the harmonics. They really matter not. They're quite small. Second and third harmonics, by the time you get to the fourth, it's not even worth talking about. But even the second and third are quite small in size. These tubes run fairly cool. Notice only 89 volts basically on the plate. They're not running real heavy. Mixer tubes don't. They're not high amplifying tubes. So, what are the four frequencies? Well, one frequency is the unmolested, unmixed frequency that you tune the antenna to. So, again, we'll go back to the 1,000 kilocycles or 1 megahertz on the dial frequency coming in here that you dialed in. So, that frequency will go through this tube and not get changed and come out here. The other frequency is the unmolested frequency from this oscillator. Will go through and be unmolested part of it and get through. So I'll have 1,000 kilocycles and 1,455 kilocycles. Now I'm going to have an addition of the two, this antenna and the oscillator. So, 1,000 plus 1,455. So, 2,455 kilocycles will also be here. And then finally, the difference, which will be 455 kilocycles. those four always get through the mixer tube and always come out. But this is a very highly tuned, very tight, very narrow bandpass filter. IF transformers are. So it easily blocks those other frequencies out and only allows the 455 through. Now, his question also had something to do with all the different frequencies that we're picking up from the antenna. And is it possible for out here in the atmosphere or even getting once they get into the antenna or various things to get a mixture that is such that it makes it through the 455? And yes, it is. It's called noise. If you use a spectrum analyzer and look at any radio frequency, center on any radio frequency, I don't care what it is. Down at the bottom, along the bottom level of that, you'll if you was actually measuring a frequency coming in, that's one way what you're going to be doing. Now say 1,000, just pick anything. You'll see it there. You'll see some of its harmonics there, but you also will see down at the very bottom a whole bunch of stuff going on. It's way low, but it's there. It's called noise. And noise does make it through here because some of that noise is really basically ends up being 455 kilocycles and it makes it through. That's the static you hear. You tune in somewhere on your radio dial and no radio station at all there, or if there probably is, but it's so far away, it's so weak, it's inside, it's down below in the noise. You hear static. That's what the static is. It's noise. It's a whole bunch of radio frequencies there that end up between the mixer tube, the antenna, and atmospheric conditions get jostled around and gets mixed, and some of the harmonics and everything else gets and makes it through and amplified through these IF stages and IF tube and gets out to your, detected in your audio. Some of that noise is quite old. Some 13.7 billion years old. It's called the background radiation from the Big Bang. It's the radiation that was put off when the universe began. And some of that static you hear when you're tuned in to no other station, no stations in there above it, above that noise level, some of that static is the background radiation from out in space. It's also the stuff that you see on a picture tube, on a TV, analog TV, where you're tuned in to no station and you just see static. Some of that static in there, all the static is the noise level. And it's the frequencies that are making it through. But yes, my point is, to answer your question, yes, some of them do. But they're weak. They're very weak. And the only stations it's going to swallow up is radio stations that are so weak they're below that. And radios, communication gear, such as say police radios, marine radios, ham radios, and things like that, on the receivers, they have a squelch, like CB radios. You just squelch out the noise so you don't have to listen to it all the time. It's just something that it's a knob and a filter in there that actually just shuts off that noise so it doesn't get through. And but regular radios don't have that. So when you tune in between stations, or there's nothing there except static, you hear static. Now one other bit of static you'll get through here, or noise, is lightning on AM radio. But if you really pay attention to it, it's actually quite weak signal. That storm has to get fairly close to start being strong enough to start affecting your strong stations. As far as kind of, you burying out the signal when the lightning strikes. You'll hear it off in the distance. When it's way off in the distance, you hear it, but it's more down closer to the noise level. It slowly builds up, coming up a little higher and higher as the storm gets closer. But it has to get fairly close before it's strong enough that your strong stations, it starts kind of drowning them out when it strikes. But yeah, it also makes it through because one of the frequencies, it makes it through more because of some of it's some of the base the frequencies it produces is across the board, so one of them will be the IF frequency, but it'll be numerous IF frequencies. You go back in your 30s radios, they ran from down around like 160, 150 kilocycle IFs all the way up to through 470, 475 kilocycles, and everything in between. They were experimenting with all kinds of IF frequencies on their, various radios and model makes and models and stuff. So, and every one of them would pick up lightning, and they also would pick up the noise floor as well as static. So to answer that question, yes, it does get through. I'll see here. Okay, he asked me about the ABC, and I had evidently mentioned in that comment or in the video when he was talking about the ABC. Voltage that when it gets back to the grid of the tube. Okay, there, focus. Anyway, when it gets to the grid of the tube, that I said slows the current down. Yeah, it doesn't slow it down. It reduces the current through the tube. I just picked the words I picked. I have no reason why I did. But yeah, the ABC basically is it as you get a stronger signal, it's more negative voltage than on the ABC, which creates more negative voltage on the grid, which then in turn reduces the amount of current going through the tube, which effectively reduces the gain of the tube. So it doesn't amplify as strong. This ends up working through a few cycles and ends up leveling off at a level volume. So I think the other thing was he kind of was curious about this Pi filter and how it operates. I had explained this once before. The power supply on here is not easy to see. The Pi filter and the power supply basically is right here. Comes up, goes through a couple windings on the output transformer. It's just for humbucking. Comes down through the resistor and then back down here. That's your Pi filter, the power supply. The same. What this does and how it works is exactly the same as how this works. And basically what it's doing, yes, time constant's involved, but really the biggest thing is going on when you got a Pi filter is time constant works because in the type of filter it is. When you got a resistor and a capacitor like this, where the resistor's in line, the capacitor's going off to ground, then this is a low pass filter. In other words, it passes low frequencies and not high frequencies as well. In a Pi situation, it's still doing the same thing. We just got two capacitors instead of one. And that works because of the time constant, basically, and how that works. But the other part of it is, what am I doing with it? I can't just block them. I can't resist them out, or otherwise I create heat. So what am I going to do with that RF? Well, what that does with the RF is it bleeds through it's easy for it to pass through the capacitors and back to return path, back to ground. And the AF ends up making it through. And it looks something like this, except then once it's detected, you just get this. Once it goes through the filter, we actually get a DC base here, and once you go through the filter, we lose a lot of these small lines that's in here. We have just mostly a little bit of DC and with a ripple on top of it, which is our audio. Now, one thing I said in the original video, I was wrong, Another mistake I made, I called this the load resistor of the ABC. It is not. This is the load resistor. The volume control is acting on the load resistor. And I believe, let's see. Okay. Anyway, he kind of confuses exactly what voltage is. I'm not sure what his question is on that. But anyway, this is load resistor here. This is just part of the pie. You need a load resistor for that DC. Okay. I got it. Only way I'm going to get a voltage, to see a voltage for the ABC line, is I need to pass that current through a resistor. A DC current has to pass through a resistor to give me a voltage drop. As that current flows through here, and you know, the capacitor here blocks the DC and allows only the AF then, this ripple, to get through. But it blocks the DC. But that DC current passes through here. When it does, it develops a voltage drop. Ohm's law. Voltage is resistance times current. So as the current flows through this, I get a voltage drop. And being the direction of the flow, this actually is negative with respect to ground. So I get a negative voltage on here. Then we have our ABC line. It feeds through. This capacitor and this resistor is another RC filter. But what it's for, as I've said previously, is to slow the ABC's change down. We can't have it. If you listen to music, okay, everybody is listening to music. When you're listening to music, there's always a change in sound levels, in the instruments, in the vocals, and everything. You don't want your ABC to constantly be trying to correct for that, or your music will be monotone, basically, almost like a monotone type thing. So they put this 0.05 microfarad and this 2.2 mega ohm resistor in here to create a time constant to slow down the ABC's changing rate. Only way the ABC can change is when we change the charge on this capacitor. Otherwise, it don't change. That change should happen only when you're tuning from a strong station to a weak or a weak station to a strong. Then there's some time, and it takes a little bit. You don't really notice it that much, but there is a little time lag that happens before the volume steadies out. Really, ABC was originally designed more for fading. You know, if you today listen to on a radio, AM radio, even a modern day radio, and listen to AM stations at night, especially, you'll pick up some what is known as skip or DXing is a proper name for it, distance stations. But as conditions change a little bit in the atmosphere and everything, those stations first might come in strong and then fade down a little bit and get quieter and quieter and quieter. And then they'll get louder and louder and louder. That's what ABC was actually intentionally and designed for doing, was to fix that problem. And it does quite well on that. But if you got a standard weak station that you listen to, it's not really what you call DXing, although it is a distant station, maybe 100 miles away, kind of low power, but you can pick it up with any radio you've got, usually, any time of the day. And then you've got a station right in the town you're living in, it's like a 25,000 or 50,000 watt station. Well, if you switch between those two stations, ABC will try to help keep the volume constant, but it's beyond its ability to do. So it's really more for fading than what it is. So but I think he was curious about the current going through and the resistance and everything. Resistor don't change, but the current does. When the current does, the voltage changes, because Ohm's law states that voltage equals current times resistance. So as this current would change, so will the voltage, because the resistance doesn't. So I'm going to leave this as part one. This is going to be plenty long enough. This is going to be about an 8 gig upload. It'll probably take many hours for me to upload it at 1 megabit per second. So I'm going to cut off right here. So I'll make a second part to this, try to answer some of his other questions. I hope this helps other people too. There's some future videos coming out soon, next Monday, probably, and then next week, talking about some new stuff I got and some other things. But one new thing is what's sitting right there. Okay, that's a Syncor VA 62A. I think VA 62 anyway. So I'll be talking about it a little bit. So again, thanks for watching. If you like the video, give a big thumbs up. If you like the new camera, give that big thumbs up. So I'll see you on the next video.